You can run, but you can't hide. When you look deep into my eyes, you can fall for the fake smile. But nobody's happy all the time. I've been running round in circles, looking for something to blow my mind. Funny how life can trick you. I always had what I was trying to find. And sometimes I wonder if God judges us for how much we judge others outside. Voices in my head always seem to echo, but you make them silent tonight.
The show is about to begin.
Right before my eyes. Things aside, I got bucks in my jeans, I got food on my plate, I got trust in my dreams. I know people can break you, don't bust at the seams. So I'll say please and thank you when God intervenes.
Today, Sunreal has recorded the final episode of his game show, spent some time with his daughter, Millie, and weathered a rager of a storm. What will happen next on I Can't Make This Up, starring Sunreal, the only reality show star who doesn't know he's in a reality show?
Shit that's in front of me, I gas me up when my mirror make fun of me. Turn my phone off, I see life is a luxury. Watching my daughter eat food with no cutlery. Wonder why bad things happen to good peeps. Life don't always end up like the movies. I'm getting tired of pretending like you see. All I know is sometimes I wonder if God judges us for how much we judge others outside. Voices in my head always seem to echo, but you make them silent tonight. Right before my eyes, right before my eyes, right before my eyes, I had you to hold me down. Right before my eyes, right before my eyes, right before my eyes, I had you to hold. And the sky is gray. I've been for a while. All I win is day. I'd be safe and warm if I was in LA. California dreaming, on such a winter's day.
California dreaming on such a winter's day.
You can run, but you can't hide. When you look deep into my eyes, you can fall for the fake smile. But nobody's happy all the time. I've been running around in circles, looking for something to blow my mind. Funny how life can trick you. I always had what I was trying to find. And sometimes I wonder if God judges us for how much we judge others outside. Voices in my head always seem to echo, but you make them silent tonight.
The show is about to begin.
Right before my eyes. Things aside, I got bucks in my jeans, I got food on my plate, I got trust in my dreams. I know people can break you, don't bust at the seams. So I'll say please and thank you when God intervenes.
Today, Sunreal has recorded the final episode of his game show, spent some time with his daughter, Millie, and weathered a rager of a storm. What will happen next on I Can't Make This Up, starring Sunreal, the only reality show star who doesn't know he's in a reality show?
That's in front of me. I gas me up when my mirror make fun of me. Turn my phone off, I see life is a luxury. Watching my daughter eat food with no cutlery. Wonder why bad things happen to good peeps. Life don't always end up like the movies. I'm getting tired of pretending like you'll see. All I know is sometimes really? I wonder if God judges us for how much we judge.
Let my soul be free. Take me to the ocean. Take me to the sea. Wash away my worries. Let my soul be free.
When I was the weakest inside, and that's okay. Yeah. I will wake up on my homie's sofa with all on my shoulders. Oh, but it's clean tonight, clean tonight. I will fake it, hide from my mistakes, but fears I had to face them just to be here tonight. We've all got something to offer. Everybody got a dream.
Everyone's got some problems, not just one to see. Everyone's done some falling, everybody needs to speak. Everybody's got some problems, not just you and me. Everybody's got some problems. There's nothing wrong with being wrong sometimes. Just not me. Goodbye to all the miles I took last year. I'm on my J-O-B. I will wake up on my homie's sofa. Wait on my shoulders. All for this dream tonight. Dream tonight. I will fake it. Hide from my mistakes. But fears I had to face them just to be here tonight. We've all got something to offer. Everybody got a dream. Everyone's got some problems, not just one to see. Everyone's done some falling. Everybody needs to speak. Everybody's got some problems, not just you and me. Everybody's got some problems. Wait all on my shoulders, all for this dream tonight, dream tonight. I will fake it, hide from my mistakes, but fears I had to face them just to be here tonight. We've all got something to offer.
La favela, don't follow this. The streets are getting hot. water. There is no water to put out the fire. Mi contar este anda. Me and Maria on the corner. Thinking of ways to make it better. Then I look up in the sky. Hoping that there's a paradise.
Taylor in the freaking face. Hey, what up, dog? The Huntington Beach PCH drive for all you crazy subscribers. Twin Dolphins.
I found a cool YouTube channel.
Oh, do I care?
Okay.
No. What YouTube channel, friend?
I'm not gonna talk to you.
Good, I don't want it. I don't want it. What are you talking about, Taylor? That's Taylor Patrick. He's my best friend, but he's scared of the camera. Good. At least my whole channel knows how afraid guy you are. Free parking somewhere, right?
Think I'm gonna find some parking?
Hopefully not, because you're gonna ask me for change. I'm gonna say no. No change for you. I'm on vacation. You're gonna copyright me for you singing someone else's song. Good. Good. Make up your mind. Does it again, finds free parking. What the?
Jesus, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. No turning back. No turning back. No turning back.
Before me, the world. She probably right. One thing that's for sure, not a stranger to this life. Got a safe that's full of fragments and a shoulder full of stripes. I don't know a nigga like myself. I say self-made, meaning I design myself. County jail fades, you can pull my file yourself. Spy rays, swallow rocks, I'm getting high myself. Damn right, I like the life I built. I'm from West Side 60, shit, I might got killed. Standing so tall, I think I might got stills. Legendary baller like Mike, like Will. 96 Impala, thug life on wheels. Up against the wall, squabble out Fox Hills. Like a motherfucking boss, ask me how I feel. Successful street nigga touching them first meals. Whoa. All my life, been grinding all my life. Sacrifice, hustle paid the price. Want a slice, got to roll the dice, that's why. All my life, I've been grinding all my life. Yeah. All my life, been grinding all my life. Sacrifice, hustle paid the price. Want a slice, got to roll the dice, that's why. Grinding all my life, yeah. I got everything I said I was gonna get on my kid. In addition to that fact, I went legit. I'm the shit now, according to the way that I'm positioned. In this biz, it look like I'm just gonna keep on getting rich. I know that Westside RSC sucks. LAPD on my dick, I'ma squeeze and bust. If a rap nigga did switch cheese and fucks, all this rap money, nigga, look, I need too much. Money, loyalty, and love, in the dream we trust. You'll be switching up the players on your team too much. Tiny Copy, that's my love, Young Supreme, what's up? And we travel around the world getting cream or what? Ain't you get off on whoever hustle seem to brush? Las Vegas strip pop, yeah, you creep the punks. After all that looking tough, all he seen was stuck. 50 Cent and Mayweather flee the scene with us. True story. All my life, been grinding all my life. Sacrifice, hustle paid the price. Want a slice, got to roll the dice, that's why. All my life, I've been grinding all my life, yeah. All my life, been grinding all my life, yeah.
I love you. I'm so proud of you. So, so proud of
Go
you.
Go for it.
She's really good at it.
Good dad. Yeah, big brother! Yeah, big brother! Eric Bennett!
That's a big one.
Yeah. Sorry, no. Amy! Thank you.
out your love, though you think you would have known. I remember I thought you looked like an angel wrapped some pain and something warm.
Good job, Patty. your mother, Patty. Good job, Patty.
He is.
Yeah, he's the greatest man.
Yeah, he is. And he That's cool.
Close.
This is John.
Hey, John, how you doing?
John Phillips.
James.
Nice to meet you, brother.
You too, bro.
Youngest brother of Eric.
Well, I don't think he's with him. I think he's a great man.
He is.
Yeah, he's the greatest man.
Yeah, he is. That's
cool.
Close.
This is John.
Hey, John, how you doing?
John Phillips.
James.
Nice to meet you, brother.
You too, bro.
Youngest brother of Eric.
I can see your mouth. I want you to know I'm not drunk. I have a bad knee.
Absolutely.
Because his integrity, his balance between personal life and professional life, everybody understands that.
Yeah.
And they're
good
to go.
He parties, but when he's business,
he's one of the smartest men I've ever known.
Yeah, he is. Yeah.
Oh, thank you.
Always being
good. I was in here all the time.
I was just April and March watched it be busted. Yeah.
Okay, so here we go. So in as much as you presented yourselves here this day, you've exchanged vows and rings as symbols of your relationship. By the power vested in me, I joyfully proclaim that you are husband and wife in the name of Almighty God. Amen and amen. You may now kiss your bride.
Yeah. Brother.
Adventure and obviously excitement and humor along the way. Let us pray. Faithful God, pour down your grace and your blessing upon this wonderful couple that they may fulfill the vows that they have pledged this day. May they reflect your steadfast love in their lifelong faithfulness to each other. From your great store of strength, O God, give them power and patience, affection and understanding, courage and love. We ask, O God, that in any time of difficulty, they may find a path to each other and to you, and may all the events of their lives bring them closer to one another and closer to you, and may the world be better for the life of their love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Adventure and obviously excitement and humor along the way. Let us pray. Faithful God, pour down your grace and your blessing upon this wonderful couple that they may fulfill the vows that they have pledged this day. May they reflect your steadfast love in their lifelong faithfulness to each other. From your great store of strength, O God, give them power and patience, affection and understanding, courage and love. We ask, O God, that in any time of difficulty, they may find a path to each other and to you, and may all the events of their lives bring them closer to one another and closer to you, and may the world be better for the life of their love. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
And I, a father, not only to Cody and Lexi, Wendy and John and Ben, but now also to two beautiful little girls. I will love Briella and Eliana, as I do my other children. I will honor and cherish our family each day of our life. I will love you in sickness and in health, in poverty and in wealth, in sorrow and in joy, and will be true to you by God's grace, trusting in Him, all of your children. And knowing you, as I do, I promise to never cease for, even when I'm here with these words. I will love you in word and deed. I will laugh with you, cry with you, scream with you. Well, you'll be most discreet. I'll go with you, maybe I will be in trap. I thank the Lord for the love that bound our hearts, life, together in marriage. You are now a grandmother to Bentley, God, for our family and friends. I plead you to be my wife. When I'm with you, everything else fades to the background. You flood my senses with joy. You are my blessing and my greatest gift. My life is forever entangled with yours from this day on. My dreams are her dreams. I will live a future without you. Today I join my life to yours, not simply as a husband, but as your friend, your lover, and your biggest supporter. Allow me to be the shoulder you lean on, your protector, and your companion for life. I promise to be there to test you, stumble, carry you over every threshold, and fall in love with you.
Wait.
with this ring. I encircle you with my love. I present it as a symbol of my constant faith.
Everywhere.
With this ring, I pledge my love to you, and I give you my love.
Yes, brother.
So, Almighty God, we are grateful for your mercy and your goodness, and we thank you for your very presence here today. We pray, oh God, that you would bless these rings, that as they are given and as they are worn, may they serve to remind us love never fails. Just as a circle is without end, so may the love this day declare never end. And we ask this in Jesus' name. Relationship. You now come to that point in the ceremony where you shall exchange rings. As often as you see these rings upon your fingers, may you remember this beautiful, gorgeous Key West evening. Uh-huh. Well, I tell you, we have a beautiful tropical breeze, which means truly we're being blessed. Right here in the moment. Right here and now. So we got that. The thunder and the lightning and the rain. It's a perfect day. Uh-huh. Hard to believe the humidity is lower than it was. I know it's hard to believe, but for us Floridians, we know it's a little lower. But really what is important is that when you look out and about, when you look out and about, remember that you are surrounded this day by family and friends, people who have traveled a great distance to be here with you today, to honor you and to be a part of this year's celebration. Also, when you see these rings upon your fingers, may you remember some of the humorous things that got you to this place. And I do remember some of those humorous things. May I have those, please? Sickness and in health. Love in the church.
Yeah, Brandy.
I, Brandy,
take
care.
I, Brandy, take care.
For my husband.
For my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poor.
For richer, for poor.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
For love and to cherish.
For love and to cherish.
Until death do us part.
Until death do
us part. In sickness and in health. Love and to cherish. Until death do us part.
Yeah, Brandy.
I, Brandy, take care.
I, Brandy, take care.
For my husband.
For my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better, for worse.
For better, for worse.
For richer, for poor.
For richer, for poor.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
For love and to cherish.
For love and to cherish.
Until death do us part.
Until death do us part.
It is not envy. It is not proud. Love is not rude. It is not self-seeking. Love is not easily angered, and it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not rejoice in evil, but delights only in the truth. Love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. Love never fails. Now, by faith over love, the greatest of these is love. Well, you know, you've heard the Bible's definition of love. It's kind of a high and a lofty one, but I think it's one worthy of our efforts. So now I'm going to ask you a couple of questions. So, Brandy Nair, do you pledge to help in the development of each other's hearts and minds, cultivating love, truth, wisdom, and compassion? If so, state we do. We do. That's okay. The rehearsal meant nothing. Okay, now, understanding that life will not always be smooth, that one's just for you. Do you pledge to work through these difficult times together and always strive to use these challenges to help your relationship grow? Thank you. So, Eric, this is a repeat after me. Remember, you're talking to her and not me. Hi, Eric. Thank you. For my wife. To have and to hold. From this day forward. For better, for worse.
Not envy.
It is not proud. Love is not rude.
it is not self-seeking. Love is not easily angered, and it keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not rejoice in evil, but delights only in the truth. Love always protects, always trusts, always hopes, and always perseveres. Love never fails. Now, by faith over love, the greatest defense is love. Well, you know, you've heard the Bible's definition of love. It's kind of a high and a lofty one, but I think it's one worthy of our efforts. So now I'm going to ask you a couple of questions. So, Brandy Nair, do you pledge to help in the development of each other's hearts and minds, cultivating love, truth, wisdom, and compassion? If so, state we do. We do. That's okay. The rehearsal meant nothing. Okay, now, understanding that life will not always be smooth, that one's just for you. Do you pledge to work through these difficult times together and always strive to use these challenges to help your relationship grow? Thank you. So, Eric, this is a repeat after me. Remember, you're talking to her and now. Hi, Eric. Take it. For my wife, to have and to hold from this day forward, for better or for worse. No union is more profound than marriage, for it embodies the highest ideals of love, fidelity, devotion, sacrifice, and family. And forming a marital union, two people become something greater than they once were. And a short reading from the Apostle Paul, he writes, if I speak with the tongues of mortals and angels but have not love, I'm only a sounding gong or a clanging cymbal. Rising from the most basic of human needs, marriage is a pathway our most profound hopes and aspirations. The nature of marriage is that through its enduring bonds, two persons together can find other freedoms such as expression, intimacy, and even adventure. Marriage responds to the universal fear that a lonely person may call out only to find that nobody is there. It offers the hope of companionship, understanding, and assurance that we'll both still live. Rising from the most basic of human needs, marriage is a pathway our most profound hopes and aspirations. The nature of marriage is that through its enduring bonds, two persons together can find other freedoms such as expression, intimacy, and even adventure. Marriage responds to the universal fear that a lonely person may call out only to find that nobody is there. It offers the hope of companionship, understanding, and assurance that we'll both still live
a very special place, a place we locals call paradise.
This service is not magic. It will not create a relationship that does not already exist. It is the time for tying a knot in the rope of days and saying, we will not slip backwards from here, but we will go forward together. It's a time for declaring vows and intentions and for facing uncertainties in the future with one thing of which you are both certain, that you love one another, and your desire is that this love is to last forever. Marriage allows two people to find a life that could not
be. Dearly beloved, we're gathered here in the sight of God to witness and to celebrate the joining of Brandy and Eric in holy matrimony.
This is a special moment in the development of their love. Through their love for one another, their lives have become richer and fuller, and both have been made stronger. Having found one another and established your relationship, we have come here to sanctify it and give it special.
Dearly beloved, we're gathered here in the sight of God to witness and to celebrate the joining of Brandy and Eric in holy matrimony. This is a special moment in the development of their love. Through their love for one another, their lives have become richer and fuller, and both have been made stronger. Having found one another and established your relationship, we have come here to sanctify it and give it special
I need to pay more attention. I knew you almost did. I was a little slow. Thank you. She's got my back. Well, Eric, I know that you're ready.
We can enjoy every moment. I can't wait to be your wife.
Hey, what's up, Eric? We just got to win the main building. And we love you. I'll see you around. He really goes all out. He really goes all out. He really goes all out.
Got it.
Ministry Israel tour with Pastor Greg Lurie.
Yeah, that'd be cool. I was just with Taylor Allen Patrick. Debit credit card only for parking. Okay, I should only go. We're getting here. We're here. We're here. We're here. Everybody lying. There's a line here.
Thank you.
Yeah!
I don't want the life I've been living. It was sort of like a process of elimination. I knew what I didn't want to do, but what did I want? Why was I on this earth? And so when I trenched on this canvas, one of my druggy friends, because I was using drugs then, said, Greg, really be careful. I said, the last thing you will ever see is Greg Laurie become a Jesus freak. Famous last words, right? But here's what happened. I was walking across my high school campus, and I saw a group of Christians sitting in a circle, singing songs to Jesus. They were simple songs, maybe like four. Why is tonight listening to me? Jesus Christ is going to change your life tonight. People, open your heart. So what I'd like to do is have a word of prayer, and then we'll continue. Let's all pray. Father, we're glad to be here tonight. And now I'm praying for every person who is joining us and those who are watching and listening all around the world, really, that they can hear your voice. And I pray that many will come to put their faith in Jesus tonight. We pray that you be honored in this time of worship that we have, that you'll be glorified. And we just commit it all to you now. Lord, you rule over this place. We declare your name as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And we are here to honor and glorify your name. So we commit this night to you. Bless them, bless Dave, bless Captain, bless the message as it goes out. We thank you for this time we gather in your name. We commit this evening to you now. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Who can I serve? Who can I serve? Who can I serve?
1998. When he was 12 or 13, he was actually stolen from his home country, Wales, and taken to Ireland and sold into slavery. He was able to escape and later went back to his home country, Wales, and there he began the love of Jesus. His whole life changed. Amen.
Amen.
He started out to the community in the nation and wanted to be a mission. He said, please give it to God to have it in my heart. And I need to go back to the very country and slowly be the slave because I want to share the love of Jesus with
him. Amen.
Thank you. invitation for tonight to gather us together in worship and praise the Lord Savior. I can't think of anyone I'd rather share this evening with you be led by. She's been all over the world and led nations into worship through her songs.
We're going for you, Chris.
I don't know what your condition is tonight. Maybe your life has fallen apart. Maybe life is going relatively well for you. But still, the issue at hand here is your sin forgiven? Are you certain that if you die tonight, beyond the shadow of a doubt, that you would go to heaven? Jesus Christ, who died on the cross, rose again 3 days later. And he is alive and he is here with us right now, speaking to our hearts. Jesus says, I stand at the door and knock, and if you'll hear my voice and open the door, I will come in. God has dropped one lifeline from heaven, one way for you to know him, and it's Jesus Christ. There is no life away from him. Tonight is the night when you can come to be forgiven. Tonight is the night when your life can change. 2,000 years ago, Jesus hung publicly on a cross for you. Will you stand up publicly for him? Jesus, right here. This is what it's about. Amazing. Can you believe the number of people that have made a decision to follow Christ? 600,000 people that have had their lives eternally changed. 6 million people that have been here in attendance at our Harvest Crusade. Absolutely amazing. Multiple continents. We've been in the United States, all over the United States, all over. We've been in Australia, we've been in New Zealand. We've gotten to share this message of the Harvest Crusade, and share the message of the gospel through radio, web, TV, all of these things. And we see these great numbers, 6 million people, 600,000. And I just love that God knows the individual. He knows each and every one of our stories. He knows us by name, the Bible tells us. He knows us so intimately that he knows the number of hairs that are on our head. Yeah. One thing that blows my mind is that for every sin that comes to repentance, the angels rejoice in heaven. And I wonder, as I look around the room tonight, how many here may have had their lives changed by the power of the gospel and a harvest for sin? If you've had your life changed, would you raise your hand up? You had your life changed by the power of the gospel of the Harvest Crusade. Raise your hand. Look at these. Hundreds of hands, thousands of hands around us. Hold them up high where people can see them. That's amazing. This is the power of the gospel. This is what we love to do. And I want to tell you something tonight, that no person, none of those 6 million people, none of those 600,000 people who came down on the field, came down on the ground and asked Christ to come into their lives, not one of them is paid to get into a Harvest Crusade. Because we believe in presenting the gospel in a free and approachable way for everybody to hear. And I want to tell you tonight, the reason we're able to do that is because of the generosity of saints in the past. And saints today, who continue to partner with the Harvest Crusade financially and help us to do what we are able to do. We will always open the Crusades free to anybody who can come, present the gospel to anybody who will listen, as long as we're able. And that's where you come in. Tonight, I want to extend to you an opportunity that you would partner with the Harvest Crusades, as many have in the past, so that we can see future generations come to Christ. The Generation Z, Generation Alpha, the generations come even beyond that. We know that God is not done with the United States. We know that the gospel message is going to continue to be preached until the return of Christ. And so we are going to be faithful to our part, and we want to invite you to help us do what God has called us to do and gifted us to do. My dad's going to share a very important message tonight about who Jesus Christ is and how you can have your life changed. And we pray we will see many people come down on the floor tonight to make that decision to follow Christ. And so for all of us here tonight, we have an opportunity to help us offset the cost so we can continue to do these events as long as we're able. And so somewhere around you, as you are here in the event, you should be able to find an envelope in the seat in front of you. If you want to pull out that envelope right now, there's going to be some instructions on it. And if you would like, you can fill some information out on that. And in a moment, our ushers are going to come forward, and we're going to receive our evening offering. And you can help us to offset that cost. You can give your generosity, that gift, drop it in the basket, the bucket, as it comes by. Or if you're here and you'd like to give digitally, there's information on your screen. You can go to harvest.org/donate, or you can scan that QR code on the screen, and you can help us to do it that way as well. Whatever way you choose to give, we just want to tell you, we can't do this without you. This is a church effort, a church with a capital C. This is not just Harvest, our local church. This is the church. We have thousands of volunteers here, hundreds of thousands of volunteer and man hours to put this event on. Many churches coming together to help put this event on. And we couldn't do it without any one of them, but we also need you to help us as well. And so as we receive our evening offering, we're going to pray, and then the band's going to play a song, and we'll have that bucket pass. And so would you pray with me now? Lord, we thank you so much for your faithfulness over the years, Lord, that you have done such a great work here in Southern California, across the United States, across the world, Lord. It's the power of God unto salvation, that gospel message. It has changed lives, it has changed my life, it has changed my family. And Lord, we pray that many lives would be changed tonight because of the gospel. So Lord, we invite you to do work here tonight. Lord, we invite you to use these offerings to bless your people, to increase the kingdom of heaven. Lord, we commit it to you. They're just tools in our hands, and we want to give it back to you. You have made us to be stewards. You have given us these things, and we want to give it back to you, our Father, because you bless us. We love you. We pray that this time of giving is a blessing to you, a sweet-smelling aroma to you, our Father in heaven. We love you. It is in Jesus' name we pray. Everybody says,
amen.
Yeah. My favorite stand, so we call. Taya, fantastic.
Good job.
Wow. Oh, tomorrow night's going to be great, too. Chris Tomlin is going to be here with us. I think of Chris as America's worship leader. Also, the Harvest Worship Band is going to be here with some brand new music. And also, Michael W. Smith will be with us as well. Give me an amazing evening. Let's pray for a moment now, Lord. Quiet our hearts as we think about the most important issues of life. This life, the meaning of it, the afterlife, where we will spend it. Speak to us now, we pray, from Scripture. But we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
The title of my message is Jesus and You. You know, we have a big crowd here tonight. Thousands more are watching, literally all around the world. But when God looks at a crowd, He sees an individual. Jesus sees you. Jesus cares about you. You know, it's a funny thing. People are so enamored with superheroes. Did you know over $3 billion of our hard-earned money has been spent on superhero movies from all the studios out there? And here's the thing. I hate to break this to you. These superheroes, they're not real.
Right.
That was kind of a Joe Biden moment there. They're not real. I know Aquaman can breathe underwater, and Wonder Woman has superhuman strength, and the Wolverine can heal rapidly from injury, though he's a manicurist's worst nightmare. Imagine giving a penny and a penny to Wolverine. The Hulk, he has superhuman power. You just have to get a man in super green. But they're fictional. They're not real. But there was a man who walked on our planet who had unlimited power. He didn't breathe underwater, he walked on the water.
Amen.
And his name was Jesus Christ. And he is the King of Kings. And he's the Lord of Lords. And he's in this place right now. You know God. God can seem so unapproachable. He's so powerful. He's so mysterious. But Jesus was God walking among us. I heard a story about a little boy who was scared one night. He called up from his bedroom to his father, Daddy, Daddy, I'm scared. The father said, Son, you're okay. God is with you. And then the little boy said, But Daddy, right now I need someone with skin on. Jesus was God with skin on. Jesus was not just a good man. Jesus was the God-man. Jesus was God spelling himself out in a language we can understand. God had come near. God had a face. You know, we like to celebrate certain people. If you're a powerful person on social media, you have millions of followers. Because the honor at a celebration is called the Man or Woman of the Year. Time Magazine every year picks the Person of the Year, and every 10 years they pick the Person of the Decade, but there's only one person that literally divides human history in half, and that's Jesus Christ. There's never been anyone like him, and we're fascinated by him. 77% of American teenagers, according to one survey, said, want to know more about Jesus. Three-quarters of millennials say they're searching for a purpose in life. Listen, you've come to the right place because I want to talk to you tonight about Jesus and you. And I want to start with this. I know you've heard it before, but I got to say it, people. God loves you. Jesus Christ loves you. You know that. You say, oh, Greg, he doesn't know me. Oh, actually, he knows you very well. Jesus knows you better than you know yourself. He knows every detail about your life. And did you know that not only does he love you, but he has a special, unique plan for your life? God is not mad at you. God is mad about you. Here's what God says. One of my favorite verses, Jeremiah 29:11. God says, I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord. Thoughts of peace and not of evil to give you a future and a hope. Now, God had simply said, I know the singular thought I once had about you for a fleeting moment. I'd be happy with that. But he says, I know the thoughts, plural, more than one, that I think towards you. And then we think, yeah, but what kind of thoughts are they? Good thoughts. God says, thoughts of peace and not of evil. He loves you. He has a plan for your life. And listen to this. God's plan for you is better than your plan for yourself. It really is. I heard about a little boy and his father who went into a hardware store. And as they were checking out, there was a big jar full of candy. And the hardware store owner said to the little boy, son, grab a handful of candy, it's free. The little boy didn't grab it, he just kind of looked up at his dad. Hardware store owner again said, son, get a handful of that candy, it's free. Still the boy couldn't take it, he just looked up at his dad. Finally, his dad reached in, grabbed a handful of candy, and he got in the car with his little boy and he said, son, why didn't you grab the free candy? And the little boy said, because dad, your hand is bigger than mine. God's plan for you is bigger than your plan for yourself. It's really amazing. He loves you and has a purpose for you. And I want to look at a story in the Bible about a woman who was down and out. A woman who messed her life up. A woman who was living immorally and got caught in the act of sin, got caught in the act of adultery. Now, in case you don't know what adultery is, that is sex outside of marriage. The only place that God will bless sex is in a marriage relationship, you see. So that's sexual sin. I heard about a little boy that was in Sunday school, and the teacher talked about adultery, and as he was driving home, he said to his mom, Mom, the teacher said we should not commit adultery. What does that even mean? And the mother said, that means you should not plow another man's field. Okay, just she didn't know what to say, right? But this woman was caught in the act. But look at what Jesus did for her. I'm reading from John chapter 8. As Jesus is speaking, the teachers of religious law and the Pharisees brought a woman who'd been caught in the act of adultery. They put her in front of the crowd. Teacher, they said to Jesus, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The law of Moses says she should be stoned to death. What is it? They were trying to trick him, saying something they could use against him. Listen to this. Jesus stooped down and wrote in the dust with his finger. They were demanding an answer. He stood up again and said, all right, let the one that is among you who has never sinned cast the first stone. Then he stooped down again, and he wrote in the dust. And when the accusers saw this, they led from the oldest to the youngest. And then there was left just that woman and Jesus. And Jesus turns to her and says, woman, where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them condemn you? She said, no one, Lord. And Jesus said, neither do I. Go and sin no more. That's a great story. Love that story. So this woman's caught having sex. A bunch of religious dudes known as the scribes and Pharisees catch her in the act. Who knows? Maybe they even set her up. And it was really a trap for Jesus. And she's thrown on the ground in front of him. And Jesus starts writing in the sand. What do you think he wrote? Tic-tac-toe, your move. Maybe a little cartoon. No, I don't think so. We don't know what he wrote, but maybe he wrote, you shall not commit adultery, and then wrote someone's name next to it, like Caleb, then looked over at Caleb. And then maybe he wrote another command and looked over at that other guy. Hey, Josh, you wrote that one, didn't you? And they left. I gotta go. I have a roast in the oven. Let's go. They left from the oldest to the youngest, and all that's left is just this woman and Jesus. And he looks at her and he said, where did all of your accusers go? Now it's interesting because we read Jesus looked at her, and the word look means he looked right through. Have you ever had anyone look right through you? Let me restate the question. Do you have a mother?
Yeah.
Maybe you're up past her a few. Mom says, where have you been? Nowhere, Mom. Look at me. Look at me. And then you start confessing things you didn't even do, right? Jesus looked Uber. At her, but it was not a look of anger. It was a look of love. And here's a really amazing thing. He says, woman, where are your accusers? And the word he uses for woman is a term of respect. In fact, it's the same word he used to describe his own mother as he was hanging on the cross. When looking down, he saw her there. He said, woman, behold your son. It's like saying to a woman, lady or man. It's a term of respect. Now listen, this girl had been called a lot of things in life, but she had never been addressed this way. But this is why Jesus called her that. He didn't see her for what she was. He saw her for what she could become.
Your Lord Jesus,
I want to accept you as my personal Lord and Savior.
I want to accept you as my personal Lord and Savior.
I believe you died for my sins.
I believe you died for my sins.
I believe you rose on the third day.
And I believe you rose on the third day.
I want to accept you as my personal Savior.
I accept you as my personal Savior.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Lord Jesus,
your Lord Jesus,
I want to accept you as my personal Lord and Savior.
I want to accept you as my personal Lord and Savior.
I believe you died for my sins.
I believe you died for my sins.
I believe you rose on the third day.
And I believe you rose on the third day.
I want to accept you as my personal Savior.
I accept you as my personal Savior.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Spirit, you are the teacher. So Lord, I just ask that you open up our hearts and minds. Lord, let us receive your word. Let us be good ground, Lord God, to bear fruit for you, to glorify you, Father God. We thank you in all these things, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
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 So let me talk to you just briefly, just about Kim. We'll pray for Kim at the end of the study, but so Kim did have a stroke on Tuesday morning, I believe it was, and so he's in a hospital. I haven't heard today on any additional update other than last night. So they may do a procedure to go look at his heart to see there might be some, what Becky said was holes in his heart. Wanting to find out why he's had so many strokes over his lifetime.
How's he doing?
What's that?
How's he doing?
How is he right now? He has a lot of, he's had six strokes, but his vision is a little off. His speech is good. He has a lot of pain, a lot of head pain.
And, I'll pray for him.
Just trying to keep him, you know, keep the room dark and quiet for him.
Yeah.
So they're not really asking for visitors or anything like that. There's so they did the MRI yesterday and they found out last night. But he knows everybody's praying. You know, we've got not only here, but also, you know, the church in Fresno, the church in Alaska, the church in Tucson, the church in Raleigh, Michigan, all the church families praying for him, as well as, you know, let Brother Keith Hershey know, so Mutual Faith is praying for him, Pastor Orlando right here, my cousin here in Orange praying for him, you know, just getting as many people, lifting him up as we can. So still believe, you know, the Word of God says, the same Holy Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead dwells in you. He will bring life to your mortal body. And so we believe that God, the Spirit of God who lives in him, will bring life to his mortal body. And so the Lord will heal him and his great power, but also his great mercy over Kim. So that's kind of what's going on with Kim right now. So even after today, we just ask for your prayers for him. He's going to need some time to, you know, just recover. So, amen. The Lord's good. God is good all the time.
Always.
And all the time, God is good.
Yes. Amen.
It never changes. So, all right, so we're talking about, especially that God is good, we're talking about the love of God. Sunday was Father's Day. Word of God, 1 John 3, 1 through 3, it says, behold, what manner of love the Father has bestowed on us, that we should be called children of God. Therefore, the world does not know us because it did not know him. Beloved, now we are children of God. It has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, we shall be like him. For we shall see him as he is, and everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. So that's what we're looking at today, as we're talking about on Sunday. But really understanding the love of God. For some people, this is a concept that takes time. You know, it's not an immediate, hey, I got this. Yeah, God loves me. I'm good. You know, going on. No, you know, this is sometimes a process. You know, sometimes we go through valleys of life and the question may come up, does God love me? Well, the Word of God stands for us to understand, yes, God indeed loves us. And in fact, the Word of God says, behold, what manner of love, what kind of love is this that the Father has for us, has bestowed upon us, has given to us, and he calls us his children. He calls us, and the Word of God says it's now, right where you are as a believer in Jesus Christ. You are a child of God. You are a son, a daughter of the living God. And then he goes on and he says, for our future, he says, it has not yet been revealed what we shall be, but we know that when he is revealed, when Christ is revealed, when Jesus comes back, the Word of God tells us that we will be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Right now, you can't see God. Right now, these eyes are unable to see God, the invisible God, as the Word of God declares, right? God, immortal, invisible, the only wise God. And so we can't see with our eyes, but John is saying something here amazing, that when he returns, though, we are going to be able to see him. And when we're able to see him, we're going to be just like him. That transformation of this earthly tent is going to happen, and you know, and we'll be with him, and so, and then he says, and everyone who has this hope in him purifies himself just as he is pure. So what are some ways that we can remind ourselves of the love that the Father has for us? You know, when you, is anybody, have you, you know, if we can be, if we want to be open up here, you ever had moments of where you question, does God really love me?
Of course. Yeah.
And how did you overcome that? You know, what did you do to remind your heart, Linda?
By the things that he's done for us in our past.
Amen.
You know, with me, all the bad stuff that's happened in my life, I'm so up, I'm so happy, I'm so smiling. So, guarantee you.
James,
you know, has quite a testimony.
Yes.
You know, God delivering him, you know, of so many things, you know, drug addiction, aneurysm, you know, and yet he still stands and you know, James, man, I commend you. You proclaim Jesus.
Yeah, for sure.
That has not stopped you. So God bless you. Great is your reward.
Thank you.
Right? So God bless you, brother. And absolutely. Absolutely.
As far as the love of God, I mean, I reflect on my family because me and my wife, when we first got together, it was just me and my wife. That's it. Pictures, me and my wife. Now you've advanced 36 years. Pictures like this. You know what I mean? We got grandsons, granddaughters, great grandchildren, children. And I can see the love that God's blessed me.
Hell, amen.
And right, and that's a good way to, you know, realize how much God loves us, and you know, and what does the Word of God say? It says we love God because He first loved us.
Amen.
He loved us first, and that, you know, at least for me, that helps me understand. It's not about what I've done or what I did to achieve or receive His love, but it's the fact that He loved me first.
Even this morning, I was going back, God, I'd like to have it tomorrow.
Even in the littlest.
What do you think?
He has a God for a tamale.
You got it. God delivers.
I think for me, I've always known God loved me, but I never knew how much. You know, like when you can restore somebody that's broken their whole life.
Yeah.
You know, just
amen. Amen.
Amen.
You know, and that's what Jesus does, right? Isaiah 61, yeah. When it talks about, you know, the Lord's servant. It's Jesus, right? Isaiah's prophesying about it. You know, one of the things to bind up the brokenhearted. You know, that's part of why Christ has come. He's the one that takes our heart shattered and He puts it back and makes it back into one.
You know,
it's the love of God. It's God's love for us. It's because He wants us whole. You know, He wants us as sons and daughters. He wants us whole. I mean, you know, when you think about even your own children, you want the best for your children. How much more the Father does He want that for you?
Yeah.
You know, and demonstrates it in His love through sending Jesus Christ to die for us, to pay for our sins, but also that we have a relationship with Him, that the Amen. Holy Spirit now is living in us,
yeah.
Residing in us. And it's by Holy Spirit that we cry out, Abba, that we're able to Amen. Call God Father, that we're able to, when we pray, we're immediately in the before the throne of God and in His presence, the Holy of Holies. We carry the Holy of Holies with us everywhere we go. We're the temple of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
So, and as our faith grows in that, we realize I walk in authority. I have the presence of God, His power, everything I need. I'm graced for every good work is what the Bible says. So no matter what I face, even though it may be a surprise for me, it's not a surprise for God.
Right.
And God's already graced me for every good work. He's already empowered me by His Spirit, by the Holy Spirit living in me. He's with me, with us, for every good work, whatever we face. That when we yield to the Lord, God's going to do it. God's going to do something, you know, powerful. And even in, like we're talking about Kim, that we believe, okay, Lord, You're going to do something powerful in him because Your Spirit lives and he's Your son. And we believe and we trust to see God do a great work, just as He does for all of us. This is who God is, because He's a good Father.
Yes.
He loves His children. You know, a father who abandons or doesn't care about his children is not a good father.
Right.
That's not who our God is. That's not who our God and Father is. He cares for us and will provide. He will make a way. You know, when Jesus talks about the, you know, the sparrows, how God takes care of them, feeds them, supplies for them, is what Jesus says. And then He says, but you are of much more value than many sparrows. Will He not provide for you? Will He not make a way for us? Will He not, if we have greater value than many sparrows, and yet God cares for the one sparrow, and takes care of it, feeds it, provides for it, it should help us see, you know, his love for us. It should help us see, you know. So, and I'd say a good way to remind ourselves, first of all, is by the Word of God, right? Mm-hmm. Is to look up what the Word of God tells us and to say, okay, Lord, help me to remember what you're saying here. Help me to be mindful of your word and of your promise to us. All right? All right. Any thoughts about that just before we go on? All right. So, how have you experienced the purifying power of the hope of his love? Now, this is the second aspect of what the Word of God is telling us here in this passage. Not only is it a reminder of God's love for us, but it is the love of God that purifies us. This is what John the Apostle is saying here. You know, it's the love of God that changes us. You know, sometimes we get in this mindset of, okay, Lord, I want to do your will. I want to live for you. I want to please you. I want to honor you. All these things. But yet the Word of God is revealing how we become purified and set apart for him is through his love. You know, who knows what the greatest commandment that according to Jesus? What is the greatest commandment?
Love your neighbor.
God, all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Or heart, soul, and strength, right? So, as the Old Testament says. So that's the greatest commandment. To love God, first and foremost. And so, when we look in terms of what John is saying, well, he's saying first, well, God loves you first. We love him because he first loved us. So that's already established. That's already there. God's love for you is already there. Just like his mercy. His mercy new every morning. His mercy is always available to us. Yeah. You know, it's you just come with a humble heart to God. God's mercy is in abundance to you. It doesn't matter the situation or circumstance. God's mercy is there. And in the same way, when we realize his love for him as well, when we hear his call and we respond to his call, that's his mercy, but it's also his love. You know, very, very simply stated, we all know, you know, most of us know John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his son, he gave Jesus, so that we would not perish, but have eternal life. But it's more than that, that we would have life with him. You know, this Sunday I'm going to talk about how Jesus says, you know, what is eternal life? Eternal life, according to John 17, is to know God and Jesus Christ, his son. That's eternal life. So it's more than just, well, God, you know, sent Jesus to die for me so I could live forever. Well, that's half of it. He sent Jesus. He so loved the world. He so loved you that he sent Jesus to die for us, to cover our sins, to pay the price for our sins, that we would have life with God forever. Mm-hmm. That we would have eternal life with God. Yes, he forgives us of our sins, but what God is after, he's after relationship with us. Right? God desires intimacy. We've talked about this before, but what was the plan with Adam and Eve in the beginning? The beginning was intimacy, relationship. You know, we even see that on the day that they fell, that they sinned. God didn't come to them in wrath immediately when they failed. It doesn't mean that God wasn't aware, but God, it was all about relationship. You know, think about your own children. When your children have sinned against you, so to speak, when they've done something wrong, did it stop making them your children?
No.
Right? Your love for them is there that you say, okay, what is going on here? What happened? How did this come about? You know, and let me, yeah, you broke my trust, but what, tell me, you know, talk to me.
What led to it?
What's that?
What led to it?
Yeah, just explain yourself, right? And that's kind of what we see happening with Adam and Eve, is that what do they do? Adam blames God and he blames Eve, right? He says, the woman that you gave me, rather than him taking responsibility and saying, Lord, forgive me. So what?
Blame the woman.
Hold on. Don't get ahead of the ballgame here, man. So what does Eve do? Right? So then Eve blames the devil.
Yeah.
Right? Instead of taking responsibility for herself as well. Instead of saying, Lord, I sinned. I disobeyed what you said to do, and I forgive you. Right? Neither of them asked the Lord for forgiveness.
And the devil didn't blame anyone, right?
The devil took off.
Yeah,
he messed up. He did what he wanted to do. He messed up. Right, but so God cursed him. Like God curses the devil, but it's like he slithers off. Because he doesn't care. I mean, he didn't really care. He already knew he was cursed. He already understood that, you know. God was just explaining it for us to understand the Savior's going to come. You shall bruise his heel. Right, but he's going to crush your head. Right, he's going to bruise your head. Good morning, good morning. Welcome, welcome.
Good morning, good morning. Good
morning, come join.
Good to see you. Please get a seat. Tamales, coffee.
Tamales up there, it's awesome.
So, you know, the devil, he came to steal, kill, and destroy. That was his mission. He came to steal Adam's authority. Right? What was Adam's authority? Think about that just for a moment. What did God say for Adam and Eve together to do? There's plenty of seats. Yes. He gave them the earth, right? This is yours. This is yours. And so the devil's been kicked out of heaven. What's he doing? He's going, no. I want this.
The earth is mine, yeah.
Yeah, I want this. And so he's going to get it by hook or crook. Right? So he's basically going, I'm gonna steal this. I'm going to steal what Adam and Eve were given, because he's envious. He wants to be like God. He can't rule heaven. He's not powerful enough. So he's going, I'm going to rule this earth. And he succeeds, you know, because Adam and Eve, there's a bit of an innocence there. You know, Adam and Eve, this is the first time that they were tempted. They were tempted from without. You know, for us as mankind, we're tempted from within. But it's because of that seed that was sown in Adam and Eve, you know, that now we're tempted from within. The Bible says that when we're tempted, it comes from inside of us. It gives birth. And if we allow it to produce in us, then sin happens, right? But for Adam and Eve, they've never experienced that before. They've never experienced temptation. They didn't know what to do with it. They were unable, because what that required is it requires intimacy with God.
Yeah.
It requires relationship with God. And so, you know, we don't know how to tell us how long they had, you know, they were in the garden for.
Before that happened.
Yeah, we don't know. You know, it could have been a long period of time, but it may not have been, you know, because they weren't able to. They were given the word and told to obey. Just one thing not to do. Because basically God said, see this garden, all these trees is yours. You can have at it.
Just don't eat from that one. Yeah.
Yeah, just you can eat any tree that's here. The tree of life is here, but just this one tree, the knowledge of the good and knowledge of good and evil. Just don't eat that fruit. Don't partake of that. And that was the one thing that they were tempted with.
Yeah.
Right. It's kind of like you tell your children, you know, don't touch that.
You're gonna touch it automatically.
Like, ooh. I wasn't thinking about it, but now I'm thinking about it.
Don't hold touch the soap. It's hot.
But you learn. Right? You fire, you learn, you burn. So, okay, can't do that anymore.
It's like I got, that again.
Got this little cat that he always wants to run outside. And so yesterday he ran outside. So he ran outside when the trash truck came. And so he got so scared. Man, he was like killing himself getting back in the house. So this morning, the same thing. I walked out and he walked out with me and ran out. But something happened in him. Now he's like,
heck,
turned
no.
Right around and ran back inside. Yeah. So, you know, that kind of happens. But where we're tempted, though, of those things, like, don't do that, right? But look at what the Word of God is saying here in 1 John 3. It's not about don't do that that grows our relationship with the Lord. It's knowing Him.
Yeah.
It's knowing Him. Yeah. It's knowing God. It's knowing Jesus. You know, as you, even in the natural, the people that you hang around with, the people that you are around, influence you for good or bad, right? If you're around people that are, you know, a godly influence, it's going to draw us closer to the things of God.
Yeah.
If I'm around somebody who is not a good or godly influence, guess what? That they're going to impact me more. They're going to influence me more. You know, it's if I'm around somebody and it's like, man, all they want to do is just, you know, gossip or you know, get into these things. Well, guess what? That's going to affect you. You know, I'm going to start talking more. I'm going to start, you know, living in that. It's somebody that, you know, their world is all about this one thing. Well, it, you know, as I'm with them more and more, that's going to start influencing me. It's a real thing. And it's the same thing with God. As we hunger and thirst after righteousness, Jesus says we will be filled. You'll be filled. You'll be filled with the Word of God, the Spirit of God, right? The if you're hungering after the Word of God, you'll be satisfied. If you're thirsty for the Holy Spirit, right? The Bible describes the Spirit of God like living water. If you're thirsty for the living water of the Spirit, you'll be satisfied. And these are the things that we press into. These are the things that we, as we grow in God, we realize this is what I need. This is what I was made for. And as we look into the Word of God, you realize this is what God wants for you. He designed, because how great of a love has He bestowed upon you? He says, I want you. You're my son. You're my daughter. I value you. I made you. I planned for you. I prepared for you. All of this. And so seek me. Press into these things, right? But as the Word of God says, if you seek me, you will find me when you search for me with all your heart. This is God's heart towards us. Yes, sir.
Just piggybacking on what you said as far as He wants us to know Him, like the Scripture says. And a lot of times when we see that, we think to know means knowledge-wise, but it's talking about an intimate relationship.
Yes, amen.
You know, I never forget, I visited this church one time and a guy was talking about Michael Jordan. Everybody knows who he is. He probably has some of his shoes and jersey and stuff like that. And,
yes.
He probably knows some things about what he did when he played. But if he was in the presence where you were and you walked up and said, hey, Michael, how you doing? He would say, sorry, I don't know you. Mm-hmm. In other words, you don't have a relationship with him. So that's what God wants with us too, is a relationship. You know, not just knowledge, oh, I know this. Not just knowledge of the Word, but an intimate relationship with Him. And that comes by spending time. Because even in regular relationships, if you don't spend time with your spouse or your significant other or your kids, that relationship suffers. Yeah. And so that's what God desires from us as well, you know. And I recommend the ultimate way, coupled with the Word, is with the Holy Spirit. As you more you speak in tongues and use your gift, set some time out and pray and read, you will see.
Yes, that's good.
How you transform, you know, and it's an awesome feeling. And then you really experience the love of God, you know. You start hearing God speak to you on certain things.
That's good. You know, so, and we talked about on Sunday, right? Jude, looking at Jude, it says this in verse, there's only one chapter in Jude, so Jude 1. But it says in verse 20 and 21, it says, but you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. So what is that? Praying in the Holy Spirit, speaking in tongues. But then it says in verse 21, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. Word of God is saying, how do you keep yourself in the love of God? By praying in the Spirit. This is, because what is praying in the Spirit? According to 1 Corinthians 14:4, it's you build yourself up, right? The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 14:4 that he who prays in a tongue strengthens or edifies himself. Yeah. And then it says he who prophesies strengthens or edifies the church. So when you're praying in the Spirit, praying in tongues, that's you're strengthening yourself. And according to Jude, when you connect that with Jude, this is how you stay in the love of God. We go, man, I want the love of God for me, but I struggle with that. I struggle with, you know, staying in the love of God. Things distract me. Well, how we do that, according to Jude, is we pray in our most holy faith, building ourselves up, rather, in our most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. And it says, this is how you keep yourself in the love of God and looking to the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And so this is what the Word of God says, how you have relationships. So what are you doing when you're praying in the Spirit? You're relating to God. Because the Bible says, Paul says that when you pray in the Spirit, you're speaking mysteries to God. It's not for everybody else to understand. And sometimes for us, it's not necessarily that we understand it in that moment. But you're strengthening your spirit. You're building up your spirit. You're building up your most holy faith by building up your spirit, James.
What's the difference between just praying in the spirit to God?
So praying in the spirit is when you're speaking in tongues, right? It comes from the baptism of the Holy Spirit.
That's the thing, like, I don't know how to speak in tongues, so.
Well, so this is something that we can pray about for you.
Yeah.
Right? But so this is what I would recommend, that you read, for example, the book of Acts, right, as well as what I've just referenced here, Jude 1.
Right.
But book of Acts, so you have Acts chapter 10, you have the story of Cornelius's family. And that whole passage, that's when Peter receives the vision, and all the animals are on the sheet, and
yeah,
and he says, you know, God says, you know, kill and eat, and Peter's like, no, Lord, I've never eaten anything unclean, and the Lord says, don't ever say that anything I've made is unclean, and that was for Peter to know that he could go to the Gentiles. He goes to Cornelius, the centurion, and all of his family.
Yeah.
And it happens that the Holy Spirit falls upon them the same way that God fell upon the disciples in Jerusalem on the day of Pentecost. Now, one thing that's important to understand with why I reference Acts chapter 10 as opposed to 2, there are a lot of people that will say that Acts chapter 2, what happened was they started speaking in tongues, but they were speaking in other languages. But see, that's not the case, because Cornelius, it's his family. They're not from a different, yeah, they're not from different places in the world. They all speak the same language. And there's a differentiation, even though Peter and the disciples say, the same way that it happened to us in the upper room, it happened upon them. So why should we forbid baptizing, water baptism? If they've received the baptism of the Holy Spirit, we can't refuse water baptism.
Does the Holy Spirit just naturally one day, like, give you that power to speak in tongues?
Absolutely. It's available to everybody. What does it say in Joel? It says that in the end, last days, that the Holy Spirit will be poured out upon my men servants and my maid servants. That God was going to pour out his Holy Spirit. Old Testament saints, only a few had the Holy Spirit. Abraham, Moses, David, you know, there was individuals that we read about in the Old Testament. But what's happened in Christ, when Christ died on the cross, the veil is torn from the top to bottom.
Yeah,
that was the Holy of Holies. That's where the Holy Spirit was. Now it's been torn down. Yes, it means we have access to God, but now it also means that the Holy Spirit is available for everybody who believes. And when we read in the book of Acts, you follow it along, you see, how did it happen? They were praying in the upper room. They're asking God, because Jesus told them, you know, go to Jerusalem and wait for the promise of the Father, that what Joel prophesied, that was God's promise. He's going to pour his spirit on his people. So he says, go and wait there, right? 50 days after the resurrection, day of Pentecost. You know, this is when the Holy Spirit falls, you know, and it says it looked like they saw like tongues of fire over everybody's head. The Holy Spirit filled them. And then the evidence of the filling of the Holy Spirit was they were speaking in tongues.
Yeah.
And so there's a lot of confusion that comes from it, because everybody has all these ideas. And some even go, well, if you speak in tongues, you know, you need to be speaking another language to other people. No, because that's what happened in the second chapter of Acts, to help everyone hear about the glory of God, because they were celebrating the Feast of Pentecost. Everybody was in Jerusalem. And so they're hearing God being proclaimed. There's a miraculous work being happened. But the baptism of the Holy Spirit was the speaking in tongues. It's not necessarily that you're speaking in a different language. So Acts chapter 10 confirms that, because it's Cornelius's family. They're not other people from different areas. You know, they're all speaking the same language, but it was because they started speaking in tongues. So that's what happens there. Acts chapter 19 also is another good passage. That's when Peter comes and talks to the brothers. I think they're in Ephesus, and he says, you know, what baptism, you know, are you like? What do you know? Like, what have you learned in God? And they're like, they knew John's baptism, meaning they'd been water baptized.
Right.
And so he says, well, let me help you know an even better way, because again, God desires intimacy. What's the whole point? People, when we don't understand what speaking in tongues is, we think, oh no, that's weird, and you know, it gets all crazy and all this kind of, well, because some people have done that and they've gotten a little overboard, but that's not what God's intention was. God's intention of why he gives you his spirit is so that you cry out, Abba. So that you have relationship, you have intimacy with God. It's not about, you know, getting out in front of everybody and look at how great I am and look at, I can speak in tongues and I'm all, you know, I'm awesome. No, it's relationship with God, but it's also power. Jesus says you will, the Holy Spirit will come upon you. You will be a powerful witness for me. Amen. In Jerusalem. Amen, yeah. And in Judea and Samaria and the outermost. You know, God gives us the Holy Spirit to be a witness. In the earth, you know why we have the Holy Spirit is you know, it's an evidence of that God is with us, right? It's the Galatians 5, 22 and 23. It's called the fruit of the Holy Spirit. When how we're able to love and to have joy and to have peace and to show kindness and have patience. That's a big thing. Everybody's like, oh, you know, Lord, I need patience. The Holy Spirit gives us patience. That's the evidence that we have patience is the Holy Spirit. So how do I need to, it all starts with love, right? Love, joy, peace, patience. Yes. So Jude is telling us, keep yourself, right? Building up your most holy faith, keeping yourself in the love of God. If I'm impatient, it's like, Lord, man, I'm struggling in the love of God. And so what I got to do, I got to pray in the Spirit. I got to go spend time with God. I got to go spend that time of intimacy with God and just, and that's why I start praying in the Spirit. And then as I'm doing that, the Spirit of God, that still small voice, starts to speak and starts to say, hey, what are you impatient about? What are you worried about? What's really going on? This is what's really going on with you. You think I won't provide for you. You think I won't make a living. You think that I've forgotten you. You know, all the things, because the Spirit knows everything going on inside of you. Right? God doesn't have to figure you out.
He already knows us.
But many times it's just us quieting down, getting out of all the distractions, and just saying, Lord, I'm just coming to spend time with you. I know you want to spend time with you. I know you, this is what you desire. And so this is what Jesus is praying in John 17. He says this. Let me read verses 1 through 3. Jesus spoke these words, lifted up his eyes to heaven, and he said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you, as you have given him authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. So let me stop right there. Remember when we were reading earlier, John 3:16, right? God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have eternal life. Okay, so remember that. So, and Jesus is saying this here, that he should give eternal life to as many as you have given him. And he explains it here in verse 3 as he's praying to the Father. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. That's eternal life.
Amen.
That's what eternal life encompasses, is to know him. So we start to know eternal life here in this life by knowing him. Because that's what we're going to do in eternity. We're going to know him. We're going to be one with him, all of us together. And so, you know, you look at that. It's not about, you know, naked babies on clouds with wings. You know, we see people paint these depictions and all this nonsense. No, that's not what it is. It's being one with God. It's being one with him. And one, we're going to be one with each other. And that's kind of hard to grasp. You know, maybe the closest thing that we can get of it in this life is just our love for each other, how we care about each other. You know, that what you feel in your heart, man, I love these people. Whatever I need to do for them, I'm there for them. I want to help them. I want to be together with them. I want to just see them, just spend time with them. Just tell them I love them and then hear that they love me back. And that's part of being one. And so that's a little bit of a scratch of the surface of what being one with God is. But it's going to be good. Because the Bible says, in your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Hi, Janet. Welcome. So, you know, and grasp that that's what heaven, without really giving us, you know, much more of a description, that's what it's going to be like. It's going to be good. There's going to be nothing about it that you're going to go, oh, I don't know that I want to experience that. No, because the love of God is working in us. Perfect love casts out all fear, according to 1 John 4. Right? So let's go look at that. Turn to 1 John 4. So
So 1 John 4, it says this, verse 17. It says, love has been perfected among us in this. This is how we realize that the love of God is working in you. That this is, the Bible says, perfected or completed. Because there's going to be a day where we'll see this completion, but it says, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Because as he is, so are we in this world. What did he say before? What did we read earlier in 1 John 3? That when we see him, we will be like him. So when you know that, because of the love of God, when you know that when you see him, you're going to be like him. So when it comes to this passage in the next chapter, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. That we're already like that now. That we're already one with him. And so when he comes, we have boldness. We don't have fear about the day of judgment. We have boldness. You might recall, we talked about the judgment seat of Christ. Who remembers what the judgment seat of Christ is? It's compared to when judges at a race, like a sporting event, like who wins the race, the judges are there saying, okay, you won. You got first place, right? You came in second, you came in third, right? They're measuring, but we're not racing against anybody. It's for us. This race is ours and ours alone. So that means that everybody who finishes this race gets the crown, right? The winner's crown. That's the judgment seat of Christ. He's going to say, you believe, I know you. Amen. Enter into my rest, good and faithful servant. You did what I asked you to do. This is all prepared for you. This mansion is prepared for you. This, I went to go and make a place for you. Your place is here. It's been waiting for you. Well done. Well done. I was waiting for you. You did it. That's the judgment seat of Christ. We
finish the race.
Finish the race. Don't give up.
Don't veer.
Right? Don't just lay there. Righteous man falls seven times, but he gets up. So get up. Get up and keep following Jesus. Keep going, okay. Even if you fall and stumble, dust yourself off. You see Jesus right there in front of you. Keep on following him. Right? The Greek word for Christians, cristianitos. Right? It sounds like Spanish, but it's Greek. And this is what it means to follow Jesus. That's what it means. It literally means that in the Greek. It means a follower of Christ. You know, so that's what Christians were called in the book of Acts at the Church of Antioch. They first were called Christians. And people started calling them because it meant that these people, they follow Jesus, or they follow the ways of Jesus. And so they were called that because they exemplified that. It's the same thing in our lives. You just keep your eyes on Jesus. The Word of God tells us. Amen. Looking unto Jesus in Colossians. You know, that's where we're looking. That's what our focus is. You keep, well, what about this distraction? Nope, I'm going to keep looking at Jesus. What about this? I'm going to keep looking at Jesus. All right, this stumbling block is right in front of me. I'm going to keep looking to Jesus because I know he's right there, right in front of me. You got to keep looking to him. So when we have it, and when we know, based on the love of God, according to what 1 John 4 is saying, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Let me turn the air conditioning on. That we may have boldness in the day of judgment. Right, because of we know the love of God. The love of God is working in us. That we know that God loves us. Because we love him, because he first loved us. If we don't know that he first loved us, how are we going to love God? Some people will make an attempt, but you can't know God if you don't first know that he loves you. You don't know God. If you don't know that God first loves you, really you gotta say, yeah, I gotta be honest here. I gotta go back and Let's start this over again. Let's go back to, you know, the basics here. And let me understand my heart that God loves me. So it's going to give us boldness. So the love of God is going to give us a boldness so that we look for, Lord, come back, Jesus. Come back. Yes, I want you to save my family. And I want you to work these things out. I don't want to see anybody lost. And I want to make sure that they know. And I'm going to tell them so that way they know. But come back, Lord Jesus. Right? This is what the apostles, they pray. Maranatha, that's what it means. Come back, Lord Jesus. We look forward to your return. Because this is what John is saying. This is the heart that God
wants us to have in us. Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. And then he goes on and explains more. Verse 18, it says, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Yeah. So what's the, when we're feeling fear, worry, anxiety, whatever it might be, what's the resolution to that is the love of God.
Amen.
Go back to the love of God.
Call out to him.
Go back to the love of God. Right? This is what the church of Ephesus in Revelation 2, this is what they forgot. Jesus says they forgot to love. They were the loveless church. And so what does Jesus do? He says, go back to the first things. Go back to the love of God. Get you focus on the love of God. And that's what's going to turn everything around for you. You go back to the fact that God loves you, and that you in turn can love him, and then you loving him is going to cause you to love your brothers and sisters. Amen. Love them the way God loves them, not the way you think they deserve to be loved. Yes, sir.
Also, for me, like if I feel something is trying to make me anxious or afraid or something, immediately I refer to the scripture that Jesus said he would never leave you nor forsake you.
Amen.
So amen. Lord, no matter what comes my way, well, Lord, I know you see everything, you know everything. I know that you're with me. I know that you love me. And you said you'll never leave me nor forsake me. And that just immediately wipes any fear or
praise God.
Yeah, any problem you go through, even if you blow it, even if you make a mistake, you know, Lord, I thank you that you love me still.
Yes.
You know, you said come boldly to the throne of grace. He said he didn't say come like I'm nothing or like what he said. He said come boldly to the throne of grace that you may obtain mercy and find grace in the time of need. So every day that's how I start my prayer. Lord, I come boldly to the throne of grace and I may obtain mercy in my time of need, and then I add on there because I need you every time, amen, all the time.
Yeah.
So, you know, and I just thank him for it. So that really helps me, like when you go through stuff, is you just remind yourself, Lord, I know you see everything that's going on. You know, I know you still love me. I know you said you'd never leave me nor forsake me. So by faith, I'm going to cap on that. Just show me how to get out of this situation.
Amen. Amen. It's like Jeremiah, right? You need something, he comes running to you. Dad, right? This is what's going on, right? And you're like, let's take care of this, right? A good father is not going to reject their child. And so, you know, maybe we may have had fathers that didn't do that, but that's not who God is. And so that's why we need to know God. That's why Jesus prayed this, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ. This is what the heart of God is at the very at the very base of it is that you know God, that we know him. This is salvation. This is eternal life, is knowing God. This is the life of God. Jesus says, I came to bring life and life more abundantly. Well, that comes by knowing God. It's not this, okay, I received Jesus in my heart as my Lord and Savior, and I'm going to, you know, try and do my best and try and be a good person. And that's not knowing God.
Right.
First of all, it's the call comes out from God first. The invitation is from God. And you hear that and you respond and you say, and you become a follower of Jesus. What does he say to, when we read through the Gospels, everyone that he'd come across, he'd say, take up your cross, deny yourself, follow me. Right? This is the way of eternal life. This is how it comes together. And so we respond, okay, well, we're going to learn by the word of God. We're going to learn by having his spirit in us and realizing what God has purposed for us and what the word of God, how the word of God tells us what eternal life is really like. And it comes first by knowing him. So going on here, you know, it says, as we're reading, there's no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. Fear involves torment. He who fears has not been made perfect in love. So if I fear, right, and thank you, James, for sharing that. That's perfect. You know, if I fear the love of God, I'm running on empty, right? I'm running on empty of the love of God. I'm forgetting, first of all, that God loves me. I'm forgetting, and it might be, maybe it's a relationship issue, and I'm mad at them. So I'm forgetting that God loves them too, the same way that he loves me. Right? If I'm focused on that, I've forgotten completely. Well, you know what? Just as much as God loves me, he loves them too.
Yeah. Amen.
And so, Lord, help me to love them the way you love them. Amen. Right? If I'm upset with my brother, my sister, I'm upset with my wife, okay, she's a child of God. And he loves her just as much as he loves me. And so there's a disconnect that's happened in me. I've forgotten the love of God. I've forgotten to love her the way he loves her. I've forgotten that, and I need to come back to that. Right? Because what happens is when I forget that, doesn't matter whatever level, whatever issue, fear is creeping in. That's the devil. Steal, kill, and destroy. That's where he lives. Because the Bible says fear involves torment. God does not torment.
Devil does.
And he's going to be thrown in, you know, one day into the lake of fire and receive the ultimate torment. But that's not God. That's not God. When you hear people say, oh, well, God did this. No, they don't know God. Amen. That's not what the Word of God says. We know God, one, by his Spirit, but also by the Word of God. We live by what the Word of God says. Man doesn't live by bread alone, but he lives by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. Sir?
Just the scripture came, God has not given us the spirit of fear, but instead he's given us power.
Love.
And power sounds great. So if our mind is not sound, then we need to go to God and his word and find out whatever the issue is. Okay, well, how should we deal with this based on the word of God?
Amen. You know? Amen. And that's right. That's perfect example, James. That's how God, that's how the Spirit of God comes to you, right? He's with you inside. But what I mean is that's how he's going to be speaking to you. Love, power, sound mind. Right? God is not the author of chaos or confusion, right? But peace. God, when you settle yourself down, you say, okay, Lord, help me. He doesn't come to you and say, oh, you big dummy, why did you do that? That's not God. He comes to you in love, power, soundness of mind. We've not been given a spirit of fear. He doesn't say, because you're his child. You're his child. If you were an outcast and you don't know him, well, then maybe so. But you're a child of God. You're a child of God. He's going to come to you in love, power, soundness of mind. Love, because I'm in fear or whatever's going on. Power to overcome whatever is happening, sickness, disease, you know, whatever is there, soundness of mind, peace. I'm going to be at peace. You know, think about what Philippians 4 says, you know, be anxious for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. Well, if you don't grasp first that God loves you, you're not going to be able to make that prayer. Because your anxiety is going to stop you and rob you. Because that's fear. Because we haven't been made perfect in love when we live in fear like that. When we live in that place of, you know, oh, no, that God's not for me. You know, he's against me. That anxiety, he's not going to help me. All of those things, because it's not rooted in the Word of God. It's not rooted in, you know, hearing what the Word of God says. And to know, wait a second, the Word of God tells me that God's not giving me a spirit of fear, but a spirit of love, power, and soundness of mind. So all those things that are trying to tell me about calamity and that everything's going to go wrong and everything's just going to fall apart, that's not God.
Nope.
That's not God. Right? Hear me in what I'm saying. That's not God. That's not the Lord. So the Lord is coming to me in love. He's responding to me in love, power, soundness of mind, peace. Right? And that's why Philippians 4 then goes on and says, and the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Guarding your heart and your mind. That's the love of God coming back to our memory, right? To our soul. That's right. Oh, God, you love me. That's what the Word of God says. You love me first. You love me first. Right? And so let me continue on. And then it says, verse 19 of 1 John 4, we love him because he first loved us. Right? It's, that's bringing it all, that's the capstone on it, that, you know, perfect love removes all fear, but just to put a cap on it is, and then he's saying, remember though, you love God because he first loved you. It's not about what you did, it's not about how great you are, it's not about your achievements, it's the fact that God, that's who he is. God is love. God loves you. Sir.
All right, this word we've been using today is love. And I have a hard time dealing with that word because I don't understand it. Right? And I try to figure it out because as far as the word love, it's been distorted in my life. You know, by my dad, you're talking about my dad, bad parents. My mom was no better. She beat us up with, you know, verbally. And the world was trying to teach me what love is. And then people telling me what love is. So my definition of love, I just didn't understand it. Until I came to know Christ. And it didn't come all at once. It came as we're talking, I'm writing down, you know, he is our father. And I started thinking about that. What makes a good dad? And me becoming a good dad, I refer to myself as a good dad. I refer to myself as a better grandfather than a dad. Because what I learned as a father, right? And I came up and I started writing words down. One of them is compassion. Another one is wisdom and knowledge, right? Teaching us good and evil, how to live, and kept on going. Does not come down on me when I screw up.
Yeah.
Everybody using that word. And he's patient. Correction is another one, right? Because I correct my kids out of love, not out of anger, hate. I want to pin you to a wall, poke your eyes on, you know. I correct you because I don't want you to hurt yourself.
Yeah. Yeah.
Correction, right? This is your key. If you do not love us, you would not correct us. Practice. I'm right now. He's there in disappointment, right? Constantly loving us,
yes.
Even though when we're down on ourselves.
Yes.
He is okay with us not being okay. Right?
He's the only one that makes us okay.
Yeah.
It's him, not me.
And God's smile, God love is the crown, and we're talking about race there. And I was thinking about it because I think about how do I know God loves me? My prayers. I know I get choked up, but
it's okay.
That's okay.
It's all right, brother. When I put a smile on his face, right, this stuff. Excuse me, let me get this word. But this Tuesday, I went, it was Taco Tuesday. I pull in, there's these two homeless ladies there, and I go, man, they're gonna hit me up for money. I know they are. I know they are, right?
Yes, keep going.
So I get out of the truck, and all of a sudden this little lady comes up in a wheelchair, and she goes, how you doing, sir? And I am doing great. And sort of caught her off guard, right? I go, do you know why I'm doing great? And she goes, no, why? Because God sent me here tonight to park next to you to tell you that God loves you.
Amen. Good job.
It was knocked out of a wheelchair. And then she started going, well, I know God loves me. And then she started rambling all these things that what she had tripped. And I go, no, it's none of that. God loves you because of you, but you don't know my family. No. Chad, you don't understand. He loves you. I'm going to give you an example that I told you about the thief in the cross. I go, it's that fast, that easy. I go, no repentance. I mean, as far as, you know, saying the sinner's prayer, there was none of that said.
Right.
And I go, and he loved him. I go, you know what final words was that man? Because before this night's over, you'll be in paradise. I go, just like that. Look how much God loves you. I go, this is the greatest country in the world to be homeless in. I go, look at what you got around you. Health care, shelter. You go, Word of God says, seek ye first the kingdom of God, and you'll find these things. I said, go look for them. There's doors open there for you. But first, seek ye first God. You know, and I went on and went on, and then I started praying with her. Right?
Awesome.
And then her friend was there and said, hey, what about me?
I was talking to you.
She saw something good. She's like, I want to get on to this.
Yeah.
That reminds me, would you guys mind saying a prayer for the miniature this weekend?
That's right. Yeah. And she started praying. I asked her, what's your name? And I asked her, Lord, you know, I'll pray for my grandchildren. God loves your grandchildren. Everything that came out, I go, God loves you.
Amen. Amen.
And their mind loves the story because of all the things that, and I'm on the same boat.
All the bad stuff they've seen, yeah.
Hi, Jane.
Right.